the skin surface and then recommend products for your specific skin. In augmented reality, ModiFace has been there since a long time, probably one of the pioneer companies which offer SDKs for augmented reality and beauty AI. And they also are coming up with their own magic mirror. You know, seen collaboration with one, I don't remember that, but they are also developing an AR mirror, magic mirror. And they also offer these SDKs as a service or as a product offering to other companies. Now, Perfect Pop, just like you know, Ole is a mobile app, but it just allows you to do virtual makeup and then click your pictures, upload it on social network, and it also rates you or gives you your virtual age, and it also you know, tries to detect your level of wrinkles on your face just by your front-facing camera. So that's actually amazing the way they do it. Koti is again an amazing magic mirror. That's what we see in a while. This is again so we pronounce it as Bourjois. Bourjois Velvet Collection is one of their own product lines, and they came up with this innovative concept where people can come into their brick and mortar store and they pick up the lipstick. And that lipstick gets applied on their face, and they can see that in the mirror. Then they can also apply a lot of other makeup, and they can click their picture, get a physical print as a Polaroid in the store, and you know, if they want, they can also buy the products. So it's an amazing concept that Koti had come up with. ModiFace is trying to develop something similar, and it's kind of catching pace. These magic mirrors or augmented reality mirrors are also there in fashion, where now you want to go to a store, instead of going to a trial room and you know having to wait in the line, you just hold the dress in your hand and you can see yourself in the dress. You know, one of the disadvantages is that you don't get to see the mask. For that, you actually have to physically try it. But other than that, at least you know if that particular dress or that story pattern looks good on you or not, right? So that is again something that is coming up. Okay, all right. So you just quickly see this video. It doesn't have an audio, but I hope. So watch carefully, that lipstick instantly got applied on the lips of the customer. That's a Polaroid for you, right? So it's pretty amazing the way they do it, you know. And
is that French?
Yeah, that's a French company, Bourjois. So the way they do it is if they are not satisfied by the processing of their selfie, they will recommend that you take selfie again in specific conditions. That probably, so they recommend that probably the lighting is not perfect in your surrounding, can you please switch off the lights, or can you take another picture outdoors. So they're playing safe, you know, and it's always good because instead of producing an estimation or a figure which is not worth believing, it's always better to request the person to take or upload another picture, right? It sounds more logical. For people who joined late, we have the Q&A towards the end. That was just something that I announced, but just reconfirming that. Okay. Sorry, I the lipstick on the virtual mirror. No. So I, in fact, you know, I now I realize I shouldn't have shown this video. The plan is I wanted to show a virtual makeup, a very crude one, that I made just for the purpose of this talk. But now that everyone has seen this video and shown, no one is going to like the demo. But anyway, so I have a prototype where I'm probably be calling some of the people, both men and women, to try it out. The lighting is not so good here, right? So exactly your point, right? The lighting is not good. The performance may not be good enough, but we definitely give it a go. So I'll be towards the end of the talk, we will be playing around. So I have a eyeliner, eyeshadow, and a lipstick. So you know, we'll just call upon people and we'll see if how it works, and it'll be fun. So I'll also be talking about a little bit of implementation details of such a system. You know, though it's a crude one done in probably 2 days' time, but that gives us a lot of idea on what is the basic pipeline or the process flow. And then there are refinements in each stage. Obviously, you know, to make it to a commercial level, you have to work a lot, improve a lot. So those will be the things that we'll talk about. Product recommendation, just like that, product validation, we talk about, right? So the objective is to improve the product performance. And once the product is launched, you know, it should be backed up with statistical data so that it becomes more believable, right? You would have seen advertisements claiming India's number one brand. Now, who said that? Right? There's no backing to that fact that we are very small sitara in the background, you know, somewhere in the lower corner of the advertisement, just saying that some XYZ agency did that survey and they put us number one, right? But there's no statistical data to prove whether they were number one or not. So these cosmetics, because it's a very sensitive industry, a small error in the chemical composition could be very lethal for your skin, right? So it has to be taken that much carefully. So these cosmetic companies invest a lot of money in the research and validation of the products, whichever cosmetic product they are coming up with. So there'll be campaigns, promotional campaigns, where people are paid to visit their studios, their labs, where they sign up to be a subject for that cosmetic brand, and the product is tried on their faces, on their hair, and then the analysis of the progress is done automatically, and it is also verified by some experts who have been in the cosmetic industry, and that is where it will finalize the ingredients of the specific cosmetic product. So even before the launch, there's a lot of research that happens, and even when the product has been launched, because of the competition, you have to constantly improve. So if you look at the history of Olay, the anti-aging cream, which is there since many years, and yet they keep coming up with something new, something better than before. So that's the amount of research that they do, so that they know and they make sure that they are ahead of the competition in this industry. Yeah. So how does a product recommendation system work? Let me just refer to my notes as well here, because there's a list of parameters which I have, which I wanted to, so it always starts with a quiz and a customer profiling. So if you, for example, I talk about My Beauty Matches engine. If you go to the website, you'll have to sign up either through your Facebook or your Gmail or any other email. And then they'll post a lot of questions before you actually start shopping. Those questions can range from your gender, your age, to the personal preferences, allergies that you may have, what is your lifestyle, what is the kind of job, what is your location, whether you are in a place which is more humid, whether you are in a place which is more dry. So these are the parameters which are considered for a recommendation engine. The recommendation engine which is there on these Amazon portals or even on any general store, they do not have to look at these many parameters, because it's not going to affect a person if the product is bought in a humid location. Let's say if I buy a mobile phone, I don't have to worry about whether it's bought in Mumbai or San Francisco, right? But if there's a cosmetic which has to be bought, it matters whether you what kind of a job you are in, what kind of a place you are in, what is the weather there. So a lot of these parameters have to be catered to before trying to recommend anything. Similarly, the hair type, what is your skin condition, whether it's oily, whether it's dry, which part of your face is oily. Some people have an oily forehead, whereas the cheeks are dry. I'm just saying, right, you know, there are different regions of the face. So this is the level of depth that they would go in. It could become boring, but you know, if a person really needs a customer, a customized product or a good product, then they actually go through the struggle. And eventually what they get is they feel happy about it. And not just that, if they are able to successfully buy that product, then all this questionnaire that happened is empowering the existing AI engine of the website. So once the profiling is done, then it matches against an existing database or an existing prediction model. So I have a list of parameters, and now based on these parameters, what is the kind of product that needs to be recommended is shown, and then there's a list of recommendations based on the budget, different brands and different fragrances, all those parameters which were used to profile the customer, the recommendations are shown in all those parameters. Just to give you a specific example, so this is a sample product markup table. So generally, at least a few years back, these e-commerce portals never cared about having these kind of details in the product database, as in whether this product is for a male or a female, or whether this product is for an oily skin or a dry skin. They would just put the product in the product database, right? But now these e-commerce portals in their product markup table have to have these parameters like what is the target gender, whether it can cause allergy or not, what is the skin type it is targeting, what is the hair type it is targeting. So if this is the kind of a sample product markup table and a visitor comes to the website, this is the visitor's profile which is estimated. Now if you read, it's like a woman has a partner, she has allergies, her hair type is oily and skin type is normal, but the hand skin is dry. So if you read in these plain simple terms, this is what the AI engine has come up with. And so these are just few parameters. This is just one example, but it is far more complex than this. What I'm trying to tell here is the more parameters you have in the prediction model, the more accurate and more closer you are towards the customer needs. So it's all about how much detailing we have done for our modeling. Okay, now coming to two specific examples, the skin analysis, and then we move on to the hair analysis. So in skin analysis, so these are skin advisor applications, and there are these skin advisor applications are there on the web and mobile, but there are also specific devices which are mobile Android based which do skin and hair analysis for you. So the image that you see on the right hand side is one of these devices which has a high magnification lens of the order of 30 to 600 times magnification, and it is also able to throw ultraviolet light as well as normal light, right? So these devices, what they do is they have an octa-core processor, they have a very high magnification, and they have a Wi-Fi. So it's like a normal mobile phone, but it doesn't have a SIM card. It's a mobile Android device with a very specialized camera. And these devices, because they have a good processor, they are able to perform even some kind of classification problems, or even a lot of image processing to analyze the skin and recommend report the problems in the skin surface there and then. And because of the lens and the sensor, these images are very high resolution. So all the edge-based or contour-based analysis or image processing techniques work very well on these kind of images. If you look at some of the images here, the first one is trying to analyze the pores. Now, the pores in the skin are where you have these small sediments that get accumulated on the skin. So to be able to suggest a good cream which will reduce the size of pore on your skin and also try to smoothen out the skin. This is the pore analysis that they do. I don't know if people can see, there are small red spots which are the circles on the pores, and not just that, so the pores have been detected, but not just that, even the size of the pore you can see. So there are some small circles, there are some big circles, which will give you an estimate of the what is the average size of pores that are present on your skin. And to be able to use this device, we usually choose a surface on the face which has less pores. So the cheek is one of the very safe regions where you find a flat surface, and the analysis is done very well on that surface. The second image is again a very interesting example, and probably we'll also talk about this. It's trying to detect the melanin component in the skin. So the color that we have, the color of the skin is primarily determined by the melanin and the hemoglobin components in our skin, which is just inside. So there's one layer of hemoglobin, and then melanin, and then below that there's this hemoglobin. So it's trying to detect the melanin content. And based on that, they can suggest some products. The third one is clarity of pores. Now, pores is one thing, but clarity of pores is your face clean, or is there something else inside the pores, right? So that is not done using a normal sensor. That's why you see a very blue kind of a image, which is used, which is using ultraviolet light sensors. If there is anything which is unwanted inside your pores, it is highlighted in red color. That is one way that you can, by using ultraviolet sensor, you can detect the clarity of pores easily on these devices. So these have been developed, that's a good question, and I'll take that. Because these devices have been there since a long, long time, and the way they started was, their devices were never empowered with an AI or an image processing model to start with, right? They were just plain capturing devices. They captured a lot of data, and just like we go to an eye checkup, the machine is there to check the eye, but there's a physician or a doctor who could prescribe you, or who would actually diagnose what's there in the eye. Exactly the same way, these devices were there, they would click the image, but there'll be an expert who would visualize the image, and then they would report, right, what is the kind of problem. Now, imagine I'm going to start this campaign of empowering my device with some image processing methods, right? Whenever we start with a machine learning problem, we need to have a ground truth. How do I know that the processing that I've done is accurate or not, right? Now, the beauty is whoever came up with this data collection devices, I'm not just talking about the cosmetic industry, anything in general, whichever had a camera, they are like millionaires today, because data is goldmine today. Whoever was in the data collection business a few years from now is right now in a very strong position, because they have a lot of data across ethnicity, across gender, across ages, and that is what helps them to improve and make these systems more accurate, right? So it is backed with a lot of improvements and iterations of the algorithm, so that they can confidently claim that the accuracy of these systems is good. And it is continuously also, so it's not that those experts in their panel have been let off, right? They're still there. And right now the job is to continuously monitor and improve the algorithms, because with the climate change, it's not that the data which was collected 10 years ago is going to still suffice, right? So since the device is still there, even though they are now automatically analyzing the skin, but they're still catching data. The data is still there. The experts are still trying to figure out whether the kind of symptoms have changed over a period of time, right? Due to the pollution or global warming, whatever. Right? So it's a continuous process. But it all started with data. Right? Yes. What's the purpose of all this? Yes. 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 Right. So imagine you go to a store and you at that store basically recommends your product by using this device. Right. Earlier you would have to wait in a line to wait for that person, that expert, who would once get free, then will look at your image, try to analyze, do some debugging, and he's a human. He does not have an octa-core processor. He does not have a 4 GHz processor, right? So he will have his own sweet time to diagnose those things and come back to you with a product recommendation. It may even take days, right? Now what you're doing is, you're getting that recommendation in minutes. So that is the advantage that these solutions have.
Yeah, but then that data is not labeled.
That data is not labeled. It is labeled automatically, right?
Yes.
That's fine. That's fine. So if yes, so that's today the monitoring is happening offline. You know, I hope I'm able to explain well. See, the analysis which is happening real time by the experts has now moved offline. There are automated systems which are trying to predict and estimate and give you a recommendation, and they are 90 to 95% accurate. Because of the historical legacy data that we have, right? Now, any improvement that needs to happen need not happen real time. It is to be taken offline. So, none of these experts are sitting in an air conditioned room where, you know, they don't have to face the public whatsoever. They're just looking at these images and trying to comment whether the algorithm did well or did not do well. You know, okay, thank you so much. Yes, and that's offline. And one angle which is kind of related to what she said is, think about the company which is offering the service. Their customers have increased, their revenue has increased. They were able to, you know, process maybe few customers in a day. Now they are having hundreds of customers all across the globe. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So skin analysis, basically these are some of the applications. Wrinkle analysis, pigmentation analysis, sebum and acne. So T and U zone, so these are some terms which I also recently realized. So a T zone is basically your forehead and the nose. Okay, so she already knows it, very good. And the U zone is basically from your left eye to right eye, if you draw a U. So basically the cheek region, the chin region and the cheek. So that's a U zone. So these are some terms which I use in the beauty care industry. They have other zones as well, but primarily speaking, they have these T and U zones. Yeah, sure. Mm-hmm. Right. Yes. So, good question again. These devices, they have to be in very close touch of the skin. They cannot be far away, right? So, even the hair fiber, I think I have included one photo I'll show you. For the hair fiber, it is even more different. In fact, I have used one of these devices. To be able to click a hair fiber image, you have to actually select a strand of hair from the person, put it on the lens, so it's the other way around. Rather than having the lens pointing to the fiber, you have to point the fiber on the lens and then take a picture. So it's kind of cumbersome, but once you get used to it, these agents in the studio, they know they are very expert at that. So they collect these images. But again, it has to be in touch with the surface. That's how these are microscopic lenses. So they have to be in touch. Okay, so a general machine learning approach is, you know, kind of you have an image, you do some pre-processing, to enhance the image so that all the edges that we want to detect are detected well. And then we have an ROI selection. Now, ROI selection can be two ways. Either you manually select a patch or you have some segmentation method to automatically detect the ROI. For example, if it's clear that the surface is red on the affected regions, I can very well use a color-based segmentation to get those ROIs for those affected regions, those red regions. Once that region is selected, we try to model the features. Now, features can be very variety of features. You know, SIF, HAWK, gray level coherence matrix, that's the GLCM, which is a very good technique for studying the texture of any surface for that matter. The GLCM has contrast, entropy, homogeneity, and then there is the average intensity, the overall intensity, perimeter, area of the contour. The idea is once we have a region, a localized region which we want to further classify or train a model with, we have to model it, you know, create a feature vector or describe it. We call it a feature descriptor. So that feature descriptor is basically a vector in the end, but what goes inside the vector, what choices need to be made are very specific to the problem. So I'm not talking about those specific things, but here I'm just trying to highlight a basic machine learning approach which can be used to do a lot of skin analysis or detection of symptoms and also sometimes the severity of symptoms. Let's say I want to do a crow feet analysis. The crow feet is, you know, where the wrinkles which are there on the side of your eyes, and I want to rate them as high, medium, or low. Those three kinds of crow feet, right? So obviously this is a supervised learning, so we'll have labeled data, right? And so I'll use some of the features, have them in a vector, and then, you know, choose some classifier. It could be a nearest neighbor or a neural network or an SVM support vector machine, any classifier, and then have a training done which will give me a model. And then same, so the dotted line, the box which is the dotted line, is basically a framework for the classification training, which gives me a classifier model. The same model and the same process is then used to do the testing or finally do the detection of any new region, right? So this is a generic, very generic pipeline for machine learning, which involves your pre-processing, your feature extraction, feature vector descriptor, then classification training, and then eventually what you get is basically a classification result with the associated probability. Okay, another application which is something that I had worked on was skin color analysis using independent color, independent component analysis. So how many of you have heard about the cocktail problem, the cocktail party problem? None. Okay, you have? Okay, very good. So it's a very interesting problem. Basically, the problem is in a party, there are two people talking simultaneously and there are two microphones recording the entire session, right? So each microphone is recording both the signals from person one as well as person two, right? Now, the cocktail party problem is how do I separate these two signals and be able to figure out what these two people are saying, right? So that can be done using the independent component analysis. What it does is it basically takes a signal and then decomposes it into two separate signals, which can be which can make sense in their own existence. Now, what we do here is we take a skin patch, and then on that skin patch, which is a three-channel image, it's an RGB image, we want to convert it into a two-dimensional space, right? So that then I can do an independent component analysis on that, right? I see a for a signal to work in an ICA, I have to make sure that it is a combination of two signals. The image is RGB image, it has three channels. So what we do is, we do a principal component analysis. I hope I'm not technical for most of you, but let me speak. So principal component analysis is basically to reduce the dimensionality of the signal, and it orders the signal in terms of their dominance. So a principal component analysis will be able to give me the two most dominating components of that RGB image. Now I pick those two components. Now I know that my signal has been reduced to two signals. I just need to apply an ICA on these two signals. So I will get those two independent signals which I want, which I term as a heterochromatic element. I can then modify the specific parameters and reconstruct an image back. Now, why is this tool helpful? Is basically to study the pigmentation, the current pigmentation or complexion of a person. Some people may have cancerous cells as well, and some people may have a melanin deficiency. So those things can be figured out using this component, this analysis. And personally, I don't believe in those screens, but there are fairness screens in the market. So those fairness screens as well, this tool is helpful in figuring out whether those screens are actually working or not. So to validate most products also, this tool is helpful. Coming to the hair scans, this is very interesting. Okay, so the image, I hope you can see, because it's a slight dark on the projector, but what it's doing is the person is actually holding a fiber against the lens. It is actually touching the lens and they're trying to capture the image. And the image one in the on the bottom is actually one fiber strand of the hair, right? So this is a hair, one strand of the hair. This is a hair fiber, and the anatomy of a hair fiber is basically it has cuticles. It has scales like a fish. Those are called cuticles, and a hair cuticle damage analysis lets us know what is the level of health of your hair. Right. So a cuticle damage. Yeah, so a cuticle damage analysis involves three stages. One is that, so a healthy hair would mean the cuticles are perfectly pasted onto the hair surface. They are almost invisible. They just have a very fair, very thin line which is visible in the magnified image. The one on the left, in the bottom image, is the case of uplifting of the cuticle. So when the hair starts becoming weak, these cuticles start leaving the hair surface, which is what we call as the uplifting of the cuticle. The second stage is when some of the uplifted cuticle get chipped off. So there'll be a small chipping happening on the hair surface. That is what we call as the chipped cuticle. So the image on the right hand side, on the bottom one, you can see that some of the cuticles have kind of withered off from the surface. And the last stage is missing cuticle, where a complete cuticle has gone missing, which is where the hair is weakest. And people hearing that baal gaon chhad rahe hain, or my hair is falling, right? That is when the cuticle is at the weakest stage, which is where the hair starts breaking or falling. Another kind of damage is broken and split ends, where the hair has broken ends or where the hair is split into two. So those kind of analysis also can be done using these devices. Hair density analysis is again, which is just to figure out how dense is your scalp or how dense is the hair in your scalp. So to do that, you have a different lens on the same device. Now, so these devices usually come with three or four options of lenses based on the kind of analysis that you want to do. So the one on the top right is that lens where the magnification is not much, but it is able to capture each hair strand perfectly well on the scalp surface. Once that is done, you can, because the hair is a contrasting color to the scalp surface, you are able to figure out the density of hair on that surface, right? So it's basically a different lens. Sebum and acne analysis in scalp surface is again, you use a UV light to capture the image of the scalp, and sebum and acne are highlighted in different colors. So you can do a color-based segmentation, or you can even train a machine learning classifier to detect these regions in the scalp surface. So these high magnification mobile devices are used for the processing of these scalp images. So obviously this tool helps in the product recommendation. So remember when we started the talk, I said that there are two kinds of recommendation. The one where you are going through a questionnaire. This is the other one where you just go to the store, someone just takes a sample of your hair or skin, and then they are able to analyze what are the kind of damages that you have. And based on the health score that you get on your hair or scalp, you are recommended a specific shampoo or a conditioner even in hair oil. So that is another kind of product recommendation that happens. Okay. We have some more minutes. I think I will just cover this and then we'll take a break. Okay. So virtual China is a very interesting topic, and it's been there since a long time. It's not something new now. It's just that people are just earlier there were only a few players. Now there are many players doing that, and now even there are fun apps. Even Snapchat has a lot of filters which you do a makeup on your face, right? So people are just trying to innovate, make games, fun apps, and do a lot of things. But the whole idea emanated from the fact that when you go to a store, you are not able to try the products, and it's not because the company does not want you to try it, but it also because who knows, that product may be allergic or it may affect you in a different way. So the virtual try-on is trying to cater to that aspect. Another aspect is some people will always have inhibitions. They may not feel comfortable going to a store or trying makeup in front of other people. There are always people who would feel more comfortable with their near ones or loved ones. So this is also solving that problem. Now it has reached to a large number of masses, which earlier people are not even going to a store due to whatever reasons. What virtual makeup does is it empowers and enables many more people to try makeup and then go ahead and actually feel confident about themselves. Look good, feel good factor is one thing that has been coming into the picture. Most of these ads actually make use of that philosophy that look good, feel good is something that we want to sell. So what is virtual try-on makeup? As the name suggests, it's simulating makeup on self. If you do a Google search, and you could actually do that once you go home or go back to your offices. If you do a Google search for virtual makeup, the first page is filled with online free portals where they just trigger on your laptop cam and you'll be able to try a lot of filters on yourself. So virtual makeup is a popular thing now. All major cosmetic brands now offer a virtual makeup feature on the website as well as mobile app. If you pick up Korea, whatever. They always have an app now because they want to ride that wave. They want to have more and more customers buy the products. So they also have these virtual try-on ads now. Now, what does it allow? It allows you to try makeup on your eyes, your lips, face, in fact, hair color. And now even there are apps which will let you do your hair styling. So I did not cover that because that comes into fashion and we're talking about beauty. So otherwise, there are apps which will also let you choose a different hairstyle. You have a lot more options. In a store, you would probably have just a few shades to try on. In fact, for me personally, before I have even spent 5 minutes in store, my kid is always there for much yellow. So it's always, you're not able to spend that much time. You're never able to explore all the products that you wanted to explore to buy something which has been tried, which you are happy buying, right? So that gets solved to some extent. you can add a product to the cart and then you can just order online or collect from the nearest store. So it's very convenient, it's comfortable. No, so if you go ahead and try some of those filters which are there, these portals which are there on Google, you would realize that these Snapchat are more fun, you know, they are not realistic. You always find, so let's say those dog ears and a dog nose that you apply, right? In fact, the app that I'm going to show you also, it has rugged edges, it's not realistic. Whereas these companies are investing huge amount of funds to make that virtual makeup look so realistic that you won't be able to figure out whether it's a virtual or you're actually wearing that makeup, right? And to give you an example, they take into account the reflective property of your skin to make sure the makeup that you're applying is actually looking as much glossy as it would in real life. You know, so now that's like a brain wagging thing that they are doing, which I could have not even imagined. So that is the amount of research that they do. Snapchat filters is just for fun, you know, kids will just feel happy about it. We'll cover that. So after the break, I'm actually going to talk a little bit about that. Though Snapchat is more of augmenting the data than virtually changing the color of few regions. But I'll try to cover those things. Otherwise, we can connect offline as well. The data augmentation is something that Lenskart also does. You know, they allow you to try on spectacles, right? It is closely related to this, but not this. It's a virtual makeup. That's a data augmentation. Yeah, but it's solving the purpose, you know, it's increased the sales. Data says that it has increased the sales and, you know, people, at least they were the first ones to offer that solution. So if for nothing else, people just for the craze or for curiosity, they went to the website and some of them even bought it. Yes, but I do agree, it's not that good. Better visualization of products itself, look good, feel better factor increases popularity. So this is like, you know, a steady source of revenue for companies, most of the companies now. I think we'll take a small break now, and once we come back, we'll take a 10-minute break. Is this then fine, right? And once we come back, we'll dig a little deeper into the virtual makeup pipeline, and then we'll just try to wrap it up with a demo, and then Q&A. Anyway, Q&A is happening in parallel, but yes, we'll have more Q&A. Okay, thank you.
Just a quick announcement. Someone has forgotten the phone at registration. Please do collect it from security. Thank you. Thank you.
overall structure of the face. When I say structure, it means a lot of things. What is the ratio between the two eyes? What is the ratio between the lip and the nose point, nose tip? There's a lot of things. And not just that, I can also analyze sub-regions of the face, which is eyes, lips, nose. In fact, for the virtual makeup, the implementation that I'll be talking about is exactly focusing on the lip region to apply the lipstick. So, as I said, landmark points describe the shape of the face attributes. It has a wide range of applications. Virtual makeup is just one, but face recognition, is one of the applications. So the advantage of having landmark points is across time, people may have beard, even with a clean shaven. Someone may have short hair, someone may have long hair, someone may start wearing glasses maybe a few months down the line. So a face look-wise changes, but the structure remains the same. As long as we're not talking about a gap of 15 years when the person was 5 years old and now he's 20 years old, obviously the face will change. Right? But a span of a couple of years, the face look changes, but the structure does not. The landmark point detection makes use of the structure. So which means that even if I'm wearing a glass, it will be able to detect the structure of my face, which will in turn help the face recognition engine, even though my look may have changed, right? Another interesting application of these landmark or shape predictors is emotion recognition, because you get landmark points on your lip and also your eyes. So basic emotions like anger or happiness or sadness can be recognized using these landmark points. Blink detection, it's mostly to do with drowsiness detection. That can also be done to a large extent using these shape predictors. So what we have used here is pre-trained detectors which are available. D-Link is one of the library which I have used in my application. So those are the pre-trained detectors which are available at the D-Lib resource. They had two detectors, one for the 5 points and the other for 68 points. But you can always have new shape predictors trained for yourself based on your requirement. And when I say new predictors, it may have less number of points, it may also have more number of points. So all that can be done. And even new data set can be generated. So there's a group called Intelligent Behavior Understanding Group. We call it IBA. They have a lot of annotated data set of landmark points, which you can use to train your custom shape predictor. For example, you just need to focus on the eyes. Then why do you need a 68 landmark point detector? It will just consume more time of your processing. So you can train a new predictor using their own data set, because they already have it annotated for at least 68 points. In fact, I think there is another data set within IBA called Helen, which has 192 or 194 points as well. What I'm saying is, if your requirement of a new shape predictor is just using a subset of these existing points, then you can go ahead and use that data set. But if you have a completely different requirement, where you want to define new points on the face which are not there already on this, then you will have to annotate the data set again. You may use the facial images from the data set, but the annotations, by annotation what I mean is you will have to mark the points manually which you want to eventually train a neural net for. That's a cumbersome process, but that's a one-time process, and it's worth doing, and the results that you get from this kind of a custom trained model is very good. Because that's where the USP lies. Otherwise, pre-trained models are being used by most people. There are so many videos on LinkedIn where people keep posting their machine learning videos. But where the difference lies is, how have you used those publicly available frameworks to train your own engines by using the data, but annotating them, labeling them yourself, and creating custom machine learning engines. So the DLib library that I'm talking about also gives you an interface to train these predictors. You just have to provide them a data in some XML format and it will do the training for you. So the way a training shape, training a shape predictor works, and this is quickly I will go through, you know, you pick a large data set of images, and if it's always good to augment the existing data set. And mirroring is another concept where you take an image and you mirror the image, right? So that you make sure that from a single image, I'm at least creating two different poses. So that also helps in generating more data set, which is different from the original data set, but also helping to learn the neural net. And augmentation is basically nothing but you take the images, you beat them around, you change the intensity, crop them, translate them, rotate them, and you create a lot more variations from a single image so that you get a very rich database to train for. Then you generate the landmark annotations. Now, obviously, generating these landmark annotations is a manual process, and you have to do that to be able to get a good training, good classifier model. And then there are some CNN training options which basically affect the size, speed, and accuracy. When I say training options, I'm talking about the options provided by the DLib, not in general the training options. They could be few, but I'm just talking about the options which are there in the DLib. The face detection, which is kind of the first step before you start annotating the points. The face detection can be anything. It could be a hard based or a DLib or a CNN detector. Once that is done, you just need to run the DLib code for training, which will take in the images and the XML file, and depending upon the processing compute power that you have, whether you have a GPU machine or not, it will generate a classifier model. A suggestion which is always good to have is, it's always better to try the training on a GPU based machine because it saves a lot of time. Because it's not that with a certain set of parameters you will end up with the best training model in the first go itself. You'll have to iterate, do some intelligent trials, and it's only after that you get to some desired level of accuracy which you're happy to use with. There's a blog post on Medium that explains the training of a shape predictor using DLib. Okay, so a generic pipeline for virtual makeup is, I have used myself as a model for this presentation because it's so confusing with these copyright laws. So if I pick up any image from the internet, you end up violating some of the other legalities. So it was always better to just believe in yourself. And then, so there may be scarier images going forward. I'm just giving you a warning. It's just there with me. Okay, so a generic pipeline for virtual makeup is what you do is you detect a face, okay, which you can use any face detector. I used a SVM plus fog detector, which is equivalent in the DLib. DLib also offers a CNN based detector, but I just stuck to the SVM plus fog because these are just little experiments that I was doing. Then you, once the face is detected, you find the landmark points for which I use DLib, and those give me the 68 landmark points. From those landmark points, I extract the lip region. And after extracting the lip region, I create a mask by interpolating. So the lip region gives me some 10 or 12 points, but I interpolate to make it a smooth curve so that when I create a mask, it is a little more realistic than just plain hard edges of the mask. So I create a lip mask. After that, it is about the lipstick color which the user has chosen. You overlay that lipstick color on the lip region through alpha compositing. So alpha compositing is basically these images which we generally use as RGB image. They can have four channels. Now the fourth channel is the transparency channel. What it does is it is able to overlay colors on top of a opaque image, such that the color itself can have a transparency level between 0 to 100%, so that it's not completely occluding the original image. It is looking like an overlay. And I'll show you an example later. And then refinements, which I conveniently skipped because it's a whole new research on its own. Refinements is actually the key to making the virtual makeup look as realistic as possible. So this is a pipeline for lipstick, and there's similar stages for eyeliner and eyeshadow. Okay, so how do we detect the landmark points from DLib? So DLib has a deep learning based implementation, and I think it's a repetition of what I said. It can be trained on a custom number of landmark points. And the good thing is it's real time. They actually implemented a paper. Let me tell you the name of that paper, because the title of the paper itself is it says that it runs in milliseconds. No? So okay. So I do not have the name of the paper, but they have implemented a research paper which boasts about detecting these landmark points within a few milliseconds. So it's actually real time, which is why it's one of the most popular landmark point detections right now. So the landmark points help in head pose estimation, facial shape analysis, and region extraction analysis we already talked about. Okay, so once the lip mask has been created, right? So you have those 68 landmark points. It's green because it's done. So far, so good. Now we extract the lip points, which are those points that you see on the top left. And then those are, you know, the points on the lip. You can ignore the chin and the jawline. Those points we are not considering for now. From those points, we interpolate to get a lip contour. And then we create a mask. Not just that. We, as a final step, we also blur the mask so that the edges are kind of smoothed out. This has a very subtle difference in the final result. Otherwise, if we do not blur the mask, then there are very hard artifacts which do not look as good as a blurred mask will do. And there are two more mask features that I have included here, which is like a open mouth and a smiling. So, these are like additional things that you can do just by looking at the lip mask or lip contour. Once the blurring of the mask is done, then you actually go ahead and apply the lipstick. Okay. So, when we apply the lipstick, the process is basically you have a lipstick color and you have a lip region, right? And you have a mask. So, first thing is you color the entire lip region with the lipstick color. So now when I say color the lip region, it cannot happen by replacing the pixel in RGB space, right? Because it will just completely wash out the lip and the face texture. So for that, you have to go into the HSP domain where you are actually trying to change the hue of the lip region, whereas retain the saturation and intensity variations to some extent, so that the texture of the underlying face does not change, but the hue value changes. Okay, but there is only one problem, that apart from the lip region, the surrounding region also gets colored with the lipstick. Okay, here comes to the rescue the mask that we have just created. So what we do is we apply the mask to the HSV colored lip region, and then we apply it to the original image. Now there are two examples that we have seen here. One without the alpha blending. I'm not too sure if the subtle difference is visible here in the projector, but I can see that in my laptop at least. You see, there are artifacts on the edges of the lip, which are almost gone with the alpha blending. So that is the advantage of having an alpha blending. So as I said, alpha blending ensures there are smoother edges, lesser artifacts, and the transparency effect to retain the texture of the original image. Okay. So now time for the demo. What you do is you choose a lipstick shade, then you choose a shade for the eyeshadow, and you get a virtual makeup in action. So that's my daughter, and we're just playing around at home. So I would like to call upon some volunteers. Let me first try it on myself once again, scale you guys, so that okay, let's see. Now there is a lot of less light here, so I'm not sure if this is going to work well, but let's try that. Okay, yeah. And so this is the interface where the top panel you can choose any of the lipsticks that you want to apply, and the bottom panel is for the eyeshadow. And so let's say I am choosing. Oh, okay. So something is happening here. Right. So and if I choose a shadow. So if you can see, there's an eyeshadow on top of my iframes. Now it has turned blue. I can choose a lighter shade. And the moment I start applying the lipstick, the real-time nature has suddenly dropped. You know, you can see that it's taking a lot more time to process each frame. But yes, I think it's still working well. Anyone wants to try it? You're welcome. Please. Thanks so much. What's your name? Raj. Thank you so much. Let's give it a round of applause for Raj. No. Let's try it with the glasses. Let's see if it. On the lipstick, no. I'm sorry for less options. They're still in the experimental stage. Okay, alright. And there's also one eyeliner. Okay, can you remove the glasses? Can you see? Oh my god, so I think it's very dark. Yeah, but you can see, right? It's a bit scary, okay. Yeah, so we'll remove the eyeliner. Yeah, that becomes a bit scary. Yes, the bottom panel is for the eyeliner, and the top panel, the lipsticks are for changing the lipstick shade. If you choose this, then you get these eyeshadows. Anyone of the ladies wants to try it? Yeah, please. Thank you so much. Okay, thank you, Raj. Thank you so much. Yeah, appreciate that. Okay. Yeah. Oh, wow. See, you're already getting the recommendations. Okay. Anyone else? No? Thank you so much, Jan. Thank you so much. So, yes, this is the demo that we were talking about. And obviously, well, there are thousands of shades. There are actually thousands of shades. Yes. It's all about choosing a specific shade. So what these applications do, because there are so many different shades, and they cannot provide all of them in a single dropdown or even on the text panel, especially now with the mobile screens. What they do is they subcategorize them into shades of red, and then there are further subcategories. And I am the most limited of people, but people who actually go there and buy it, they actually are aware of these categories and they are able to navigate and go to the right place and then choose the color from those shades. Because mostly what happens is, from my personal experiences, the person would be looking for a very slightest of change of shade from a specific color. For me, I would probably not even be able to realize that these two are different shades, but the people who are expert, they are able to realize that. So it's always about, if you have already identified that I want that specific red family of colors, then it always becomes showing you options of only that family of colors. But otherwise, the products are huge. They have a lot of options.
See.
So if we talk about this specific application, yes, they do. And you know, I would actually recommend you go and try some of these applications of virtual maker. You would be able to appreciate the efforts that they put in to make it as realistic as possible. They actually done a very good job. In fact, the video of virtual mirror. Were you there when we showed that video of virtual mirror by Koti? So we started in the starting the beginning itself. We showed a video of a virtual mirror. It's a magic mirror. Even they do a wonderful job of applying the makeup. It's really natural, and that's the beauty. That's the USP of these solutions, right? So getting to this stage is 2 days, but from this stage to getting that stage is almost 2 years. You know, and it could be more as well. It's still a continuous process. So that's the kind of challenge that we have. Coming to the challenges, you know, so we are approaching the end of the talk. These are some of my own experiences, and it starts with the data. So any machine learning or AI based problem that you need to tackle, you need to have data, right? And we all agree to that. There's no nothing new or nothing different that I'm talking about. And data, people have been kind enough to upload publicly available data on the web, but those data sets were uploaded with certain experiments in mind. If you are planning to build an application of your own, then you have to get your hands dirty. You have to create a data set. You have to plan in that manner, because more often than not, your problem will have custom scenarios. It will not be a generic experiment kind of a situation where it will just fit well on everything. The machine learning or artificial intelligence or a computer vision problem can always be simplified or improved by making use of the context, right? If you can set the context, then you know that certain things will never happen, or you would know that certain things are always almost sure to happen. So that would influence the choice of data that you choose, all the data that you create or collect, and that is going to help you create a robust solution for that specific context. So data is very important. Another challenge that companies are facing, and we see a cutthroat competition already, Modi face and Koti, competing for a magic mirror, and then My Beauty matches, and again Modi face competing for a recommendation in gym. So constant innovation to stay ahead of the competition, that's really important. That's what all the companies are doing right now. And this is like a generic statement, holds true for not just the beauty industry, this holds true for any business that you take. Right? One of the future landscapes that I think is going to work is voice-based systems. So far, we have seen augmented reality. We have seen, in fact, I somehow did not cover that, but we also have seen chatbots where you can chat with a bot on a web portal, and they assist you in choosing the products. That's like one of the initial stages of collecting a lot of data or profiling the users, right? They were not actually trying to recommend any product, but they were just chatting with you and trying to collect a lot of user data. Now, another extension, a very obvious logical extension, is taking this chat to a voice-based, and it is mostly to do with user experience, because beauty industry is to do with user experience to a very large extent. That the more you attract the user based on the comfort level, the more happy a user is, the more chances that you will have a cutting edge over the others. So voice-based systems is going to be one of the future landscape things. Rendering realistic effects, sorry. Yes. Like booking your hair salon, yeah. So it again, so taking that to the next level, and ensuring that simulating as if you're chatting with a cosmetic expert, and doing the same thing that you're chatting as in a voice conversation. Yeah, that's an analogy. Yes, that's the third segment. So recommendation engines, augmented reality. The third thing in the beauty care industry is the NLP, which I did not talk about because of the constraint of time. But NLP is the third emerging thing which is happening in the beauty care industry. And in fact, in many other cases, well, you can get into e-commerce and home solutions. The rendering realistic effects, again, as you know, you rightly pointed out, and you know, that's the whole game. The closer that you can see yourself applying that makeup, the more are the chances of you actually ending up buying that product. If you're not happy with what you see, you'll definitely not buy it. That's another matter that you may be happier seeing it, but once you buy it and try it, you may not be happy. But you know, but that's not what I as a seller is interested in. My point is that when a person comes to the portal and tries a virtual makeup, I need to show the person as real and maybe more than a real, you know, a surreal experience, so that they end up buying the product. Yes. I have never been to Paris, but I've heard there are certain stores where you see these magical mirrors. In fact, I have also seen some demo videos on YouTube on these fashion mirrors as well, which I was talking about where you can. Right. Yeah, I think it's just a matter of time and you start seeing these solutions even in India, because at least so there are always when we look at India specific, there are indoor solutions and outdoor solutions. When we talk about outdoor solutions, there's always a problem of a lack of standards in Indian conditions, whether it's traffic, whether it's road or any outdoor solution. Whereas as soon as you move indoors, it's pretty much the same as you would see in any Western world. So these indoor solutions is something that is coming to India. It has already started coming in. And, you know, in no time, you will be seeing all the solutions in India as well. So rendering realistic effects again is basically, as I said, using skin surface reflective properties, using ambient lighting information to make it look more realistic. It is compute intensive. Then another challenge is, now there's a talk about vegan culture, there's a talk about choosing natural products, there's a talk about turning organic, right? Most of the companies right now who even do personalized product development or cosmetic product development are using chemicals in some way or the other. In very short span of time, they'll also have to enrich their database with natural elements, with organic elements, and be able to quickly retrain their recommendation engines so that a person who visits their portal looking for an organic or a healthy cosmetic product should be able to get recommended with the thing that they want. So that's another challenge that I see coming up. And another interesting thing which actually I read in one of the surveys is personalized designing and packaging of products. Now this is very interesting. So far we talked about the beauty, the makeup, the making personalized products, but even the designing and packaging to be personalized is something that survey foresees happening in future, which is going to be AI based. This now there's another thing which is a future landscape. Now these cosmetic companies, whatever research they are doing, they are inviting subjects to their labs and conducting tests on them, right? They have to pay these subjects, they have to pay for their travel, and there's only a limited number of subjects that they can have in the labs. Not just that, these labs have huge expensive instruments which are not just outdated, but people have stopped maintenance, the companies have stopped maintenance on these outdated products, these machines, heavy machines. So there's a talk that what if we can shift these labs to home-based environments. For example, if I wanted to take a sample of my skin image and see if it's how moist is the skin, right? If I can create a device which is a fusion of, say, a stripe and a highly magnified device, high magnification device, and user could just take a sample of the image themselves and upload it to the database, then we have increased the data points now to many folds, and we have moved to the cheaper but reliable is the keyword. These machines for which the maintenance may have stopped, but they are still very robust, very reliable, as long as these tests are conducted, these are concerned. So, though we need cheaper sensors, but they have to be reliable. So, that is also one of the challenges in future landscapes that I see. Increases the data source. That is one of the major advantages that now having by empowering people to conduct these tests from their home, we are making sure that a lot more data set can be collected in a short span of time. So, because as I said, data is of prime importance, people are actually focusing on conducting these or shifting these lab-based environments to home so that these tests can be conducted more easily and the companies can get a lot of data, easily. A few acknowledgements. Adrian Rosbaugh, for the online tutorials on AI image search. So I found this blog very useful for Python based, OpenCV, dlib based, small utilities, basically face recognition or even data augmentation or virtual data. So I have been catching up on Python. So this blog helped me a lot to catch pace with this new language. The iBug group for providing us the annotated data sets. Luca Anzalone for his Medium blog on shape predictor training. So he has written a very good blog on how can you use dlib to train a shape predictor from scratch. Then Reese46 is an organization. They have this blog on progressive personalization. This talks about how do the recommendation engines make use of the visitor behavior based on what clicks they do, which items they add to the cart, and which items they actually remove from the cart. So there's a lot of things that happens in the progressive personalization. So there's a very good blog post on that as well. Then obviously, Thomas Hyderabad for giving me the opportunity to talk about these things here. And GeekNet is a wonderful platform to connect with people and also, So these sessions are more like a two-way learning. That's how I always feel. It's not about me talking and sharing something and people coming and doing about it. It's always a two-way communication. It's an interactive session where I'll say something and then I'll get to learn more. I came to know about a few interesting projects that people are doing in the break. So it's a good way to interact with people with common interests, And lastly, this audience, which is you guys. Thank you so much for patiently listening to me. And yes, now we'll have the Q&A, whatever people want to ask. Yes. Oh yes, definitely. So that's a very good question. And so what these companies have done is, especially these subjects that they call upon for test, they have to sign a clause, obviously. They are paying these subjects, right? So they have this option of signing a contract with them, which will define all those clauses. But even after that, they make sure that they are not releasing this data set for public use, or they are not even revealing the identity to people internal to the organization as well. So they make sure that, for example, there is an anonymization philosophy. What it does is there is a panel which works on under eye region. Then there is a panel which will work only on the cheek region. But we collected the data for the entire face image. The under eye region will only get the image for the under eye region. They will not get to see the complete face. Whereas a cheek, the team which is focusing on the cheek region may get the data where everything else is blurred or hidden, but only the cheek region is being provided to them. So that is one of the ways we can anonymize the data. But in general, they get the people to sign a contract, but they also make sure that they keep this data private to as much extent as possible. That is one. On the recommendation engine part, you know, it's as private as a Facebook data or a Google data, you know, because everything is happening internally in the AI engine. It was probably programmed ages ago, and now everything is basically in the flow, in the machinery, in the factory pipeline. So, I'm not too expert into that, but it's just happening automatically. It's as private as any Facebook or Google or LinkedIn data is. That's because you're just providing some data on a web portal, and it's going into some database where from there it is being read and processed by an AI engine. So I obviously do not know that, but that's a very interesting